pray for Evangelist Dan Zagi, Dana Zagi's father. You remember we mentioned about him last Sunday. He is still not out of the woods, but doing better. Pray for God's perfect healing upon him. This is, the COVID is dealing with him in this way because he has other underlying ailments. That is why the challenge is very severe on him. And one of the doctors was telling us that this is what usually happens. Sometimes some things that weren't seen initially, COVID has a way of bringing them out. So that is why his situation is very dire. And that is why we keep advising, take the vaccine. And many of you attach vaccine to 666. It's me that will tell you how vaccine connects to 666, not you telling me. And I'm telling you it does not connect. There's no connection. Why are we so afraid of Antichrist? Are we Antichrist? We are pro-Christ. Are we together? We are not Antichrist. So don't worry, these things will not touch us. Those things you are talking about will come after the church is taken away. Why are you worried about things that will come after the church is gone? All right. So many of us don't want to take the vaccine. I don't want to wear a face mask. Tough. COVID is real, friends. It's real. I just need to say this. I have some few notices that are not in the bulletin. First, we will use the green envelope for those who have offering to support the Women's Fellowship. The white envelope for tithe is there. The blue for offering is there. But if you want to support Women's Fellowship, the green envelope is what you use. Band album advert is still on. The albums are still available. You want one, you contact the band leader or any of the members. Want to also appeal. Our reports, we are still waiting. A few have still not sent in their end of year report. We are appealing. We're just less than 2 weeks to elders planning. And it's important for us to have these reports as early as possible so we can read and continue our preparations for elders planning. So please help us. Those who are still left, committees, groups, zonal fellowships, please help us send your report as soon as possible. Okay, I was talking about those struggling with their health, and I'm seeing Pastor J.C. McKine. His wife was had a surgery in the course of this past week. Could you stand? He's one of our students here at JETS. He came all the way from Cameroon. And we thank God she's home now and she's recuperating. Thank you. Pray for healing. Yeah. Devotionals are available. Everyday with Jesus, Inspiring Women, and probably a few others. You can get them after the service. Want to thank God for Johnny Mercy's, Mr. T.T. Piles and his wife had to travel himself. He lost an older sister. He had to go all the way to Taraba for the funeral, and his wife lost an in-law, went down to Southern Kaduna. The two of them had burial about the same day and had to split themselves to attend to that. But we thank God for safety. Could you stand, please? Mr. T.T. Piles is here in church. We thank God for bringing you back safely. Pray for God's blessings. Children's dedication class, I think we'll have one this coming Sunday, right? So it's between 9 and 10. If you are interested in dedicating your child, there will be a marathon class that is organized. We'll start this coming Sunday. So you want to be part of that class so you can have your child dedicated. I have some few wedding introductions. I'm not sure if Isaac Akintola is still around or he has traveled. Now, because of the university strike, Precious, who has been a member of our choir, had to travel and be with her parents in Delta State. And when it was time to introduce them, we said we will do it in the normal world we are in now. So we are introducing them virtually. So let me have the pictures come up. All right. So this is the first set of couples. These ones were present in physical in the first service. That is Dauda Ali. Let's have Rifkatu. This is Rifkatu. Rifkatu is daughter to Reverend and Mrs. Williams Burger, the members of our church. But Dauda's wedding and Rifkatu, of course, will be taking place on the 28th November at Ekwa Ashaka, Gombe, by 11 a.m. Now, they will need to return to work tomorrow. So we introduce them physically in the first service and allow them to continue their journey, because Dauda is going all the way to Yola. And we don't want, because we want to introduce them, we'll keep them to go late and arrive late. So I am taking responsibility of that and apologizing to us that we're not seeing them physically, but these are their pictures. Let's have the next set. Now, this is Isaac, and let's have Precious. Great, so this is Precious. We are also introducing them virtually. Now, the reason for this introduction, again, like I said, we wouldn't ask them to call to come, because the wedding is taking place in Delta, in Warri. We will not ask them to come for introduction. Just for introduction, we will not do that. But look at them. So pray. So pray for them, that God will grant them victory. We prayed for them in the first service. Thank you. We also had a Thanksgiving. Where's Christine? Okay, Christine. Okay, good. You know what? I'm still going to give you 1 minute, because Kai, just come, Christine. Just say a few words. We prayed for Christine in the first service, so we'll not pray again now. So I want to redeem time for... I want Christine to say why she's doing Thanksgiving.
Okay, good morning, everybody. I had read Psalm 111 in the first service, so please, you can just read it at your spare time. So I'm here to thank God, not for the past 5 years, but for the past 8 years. For those who have known my journey, you will attest to the fact that it has been a long time coming. I started the journey of pursuing my law degree nearly 8 years ago, and in that period, I have switched schools, moved across borders, had to start over several times, and slipped in and out of depression and anxiety. But in this period as well, I have learned to trust God's plans for me. I have experienced divine provision and favor, and most importantly, I have discovered my purpose, and I am walking in it. Time won't permit me to tell you the whole story, but I want to encourage you with a quote that helped me over these years. It says, and I quote, "Just because you took longer than others doesn't mean you failed." We're all on our own unique journeys, and it doesn't matter how long it takes you to get to your destination. The journey is what is most important. I'm grateful today because after this crazy 8 years journey, and the band members will totally understand, I graduated with honors. I graduated with the highest university award, which is the President's Award for Leadership and the Community Service Award for my graduating class. I'm really, really, really grateful to everyone in this church, those who prayed for me, those who encouraged me, those who kept asking me, when are you graduating, and who wished me well. Thank you for your support. My mom is unable to be here today because of her sister's demise, but she sends her love and her blessings. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so, so much. And Christine, we're very proud of you, and we thank God that he's seen you through. Before I will ask for the special numbers, I will ask the Thanksgiving Committee to give a brief slot. And I think after them, we'll take a special number from the choir, then the Women's Fellowship Choir, and then the band.
Good morning, all. I bring you greetings from the Thanksgiving Committee. We are well aware that our target for this year's Thanksgiving is 6 million. That's the least, actually. We can give as much as we can, but we've consistently actually targeted that for 6 million, I think, over the years. And so that's a reminder. The monies are going to be applied to missions as well as our pastorium project, a very short story with respect to pastorium project. Sometimes last week or thereabout, I was speaking with architect Wangi Akindi, the designer of that structure, as well as Ima Otachi. Both of them supervised the structure. And we're recounting how it all started. By and large, by January of next year, 2022, is going to be 10 years since that project started. It is our hope that by next year's Thanksgiving, we should have completed that project and by God's grace even occupied it. So we would trust God that your support in giving would bring that to fruition. We have announced before now the opportunity to advertise families who want to facilitate, businesses who want to advertise their product and services, and the likes. Though the timing has elapsed, but we can hazard an extension, say, for a week. So if you're still interested, please see us. Lastly, I want to remind those who are able-bodied, most especially the young people, when the date for the Thanksgiving, not basically the date, preparatory to the Thanksgiving, a lot of our attention is going to be needed with respect to movement of equipment and furniture to set up at the Thanksgiving ground. So please avail yourself when that time comes. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank God for all the numbers, and we ask that the Lord will continue to bless you in Jesus' name. Wow, last year I was expecting to get biscuit today, and the women didn't give me. I don't know. Last year we got biscuit, and this year we didn't get anyone. That's by the way. Thank you so much for your songs, and it's been a great week. We thank God. So let's read from the Bible as we read from the book of Romans, chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Taking the reading from verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For while we were still weak, excuse me, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved from by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to him by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for all that we have heard and received this morning in your presence. Thank you for the blessings, O God, we have shared. And thank you for everyone that is seated here today. Many of us made journeys within the week, and you granted us safety. And we say thank you. Some were sick, and you brought healing to them. We say thank you. We thank you because we went to different points, and we did different activities, O God. You protected us, even in our unsecured society. We are grateful. We thank you for all that we have said here during announcement. Thank you for everything, O God, that you have been for us, and we are grateful. We thank you for our brothers and sisters who have not been feeling fine, and we are trusting you for their healings, and we continue to present them before you, knowing, O God, that in your own time, that you will bring healing upon their bodies. Thank you, mighty God, for this moment and for the Women Fellowship week of prayer that is ending today. Thank you for all the blessings, O God, that we have shared. Thank you for everywhere, all around the nation and outside this nation, that our women have celebrated this year, this day. Lord, we pray that the blessings of this week will continue to follow us in our respective homes. We thank you, we bless your name. We pray, Almighty God, for those who will be making journeys within this week. We are asking, O God, that you protect them. Grant them journey mercies, O God. Those who are traveling because of one thing or the other, we are praying that you will meet them at the point of their needs. We thank you because in all things, you are faithful and you will remain faithful. Thank you for the word, O God, that we are about to share. We pray, O God, that you bless your servant, that as he stands here, O God, that your word will come to us undiluted, and that this word, O God, will bless our hearts. We thank you, for in Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen.
Once more, good morning. We thank God for this opportunity to share together from his word. Because of the baptism, I would need to mention those who are going to be baptized. Let me just know if some of you are here. Just wave. Okay, that's great. So the moment I get to the conclusion, and I mentioned conclusion, just nicely pick your bags and go through the exit door or through the corridor here. You'll be guided on how to get up. Of course, you know the baptistry is up here and it's part of the service today. The ladies will be this way, and the brothers will be in the room at this side. And I will be participating in doing the baptism today because our daughter came up to me and said that I would love if you will baptize me. And I was very, very blessed to have the opportunity to share in her story of salvation. The mom led her to Christ, and by God's grace, I'll have the privilege of baptizing her. And I thank you, Miriam, for asking. And I'll be very delighted to do that. As I'll be delighted to do all the rest as well. Many of us are aware of what is happening in our state. How many of us saw the video by Evangelist Gidadu? Thank you. What do you make out of that video? Again?
Very, very powerful.
Thank you. Very, very powerful.
Boldness.
Boldness. Now, it is sad that even from among the Christendom, some have come out to condemn him. Did you hear about that?
Yes.
It's unfortunate that what we all are supposed to be doing, one person has come out to dare the leadership because he has seen gross failure and is being condemned and taken to the gallows by those who should be encouraging him. It's unfortunate. But I commend the boldness of our brother for doing our job for us, speaking against the evil that is trying to take roots in our society in Plateau State. And I think it is important, irrespective of party, if we don't tell ourselves the truth, we in Plateau State will get ourselves to a certain point that we will not be able to get out. The church is fast losing its prophetic voice. And someone has dared to come out to speak the truth from the scripture. And I watch one of the motorcyclists. I don't know if you've seen that part. That came rushing as if he was going to run him over. And I'm sure if they check the name of that guy, it's either he's an Isaac or he's Solomon or something. Haba. I just restrained myself. I didn't want to utter a curse on that individual. I restrained myself because it was so painful. One thing that saddens me with many of our politicians is their fear of opposition. Why are you afraid of opposition? Opposition should help you to sit up and do your job. Worst, the one we're facing in our state is that the opposition is even from inside the house. Because the house asks you to sit up and do your work, you want to have the speaker impeached? Let's tell ourselves the truth. I say again, it doesn't matter what party it is. But it's wrong when we are afraid for people to look at us in the face and tell us the truth. It's a shameful thing. We're just dragging ourselves in the streets. Let us wake up and be like our brother and speak the truth. Whether it is whoever, let us tell the truth. That is what God expects us to do wherever we are. And that is what our passage today is going to help us to see why we have the platform to do that. And I want to invite us to open to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. As we have in the bulletin, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 from verse 16. But before we read, let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word that is yea and amen. And as we're holding your word in our hands, Lord, speak to our hearts and grant us understanding. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. 2 Corinthians 5, from verse 16 to 21. Since then, we know what it is to fear the Lord. We try to persuade others. What we are is plain to God. And I hope it is also plain to your conscience. Oh, forgive me. I've gone to 11. But let me jump to 16. So from now on, We regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them, and he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. 21. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Reconciled to reconcile. That is the topic we're looking at today. And all through this year, we've been looking at the theme in the whole of Equa, Christ in you, the hope of glory. And in the course of this year, just to bring us up speed, we've looked at, now we're on the third block, we've looked at two other blocks, we're on the third block, and we hope to end with the fourth one. Just shortly, we'll get into it. But the first talked about the person and the ministry of Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah. And the second, we took time to study Colossians. Now we are looking at this hope of glory. And we said, first, even here on earth, we are able to experience in part that glory. And the last block we will look at and to close the year with is that glory that we will share with Christ when we get to heaven. And you can see how this theme and even the topic we're looking at today connects with the two things that are happening in church today. And the message will seek to tie up all of them together. And one of the things is the Women's Week, and the sub-theme that the Women's Week has been looking at says, when all seems dark, Christ is your hope of glory. And that is taken from Zechariah chapter 4, from verse 1 to 14. And I want to thank the Christian Education Elder. He's really done a great job and has made my work easy by breaking a lot of the things that would have taken time to say from here today. Quite an interesting study. And the other item that will be tying up together is baptism. We'll be observing baptism in the course of the service. And again, it is one platform the Lord has presented to us. Through it, we are showing ourselves as those who are called into the ministry and the business of reconciling the world to God. And you would agree with me that all of these activities capture the heart of the ministry of reconciliation that Jesus Christ himself represents. Now, to say something briefly about the person of Paul, when you get to know Paul better, you can get the depth of his message. His encounter of Jesus on his way to Damascus shaped his life, shaped his theology, and gave Paul the ministry of reconciliation that he's talking about. Paul's transformation, if you look at the story in Acts, was a radical transformation. It was almost a 360, a total and complete turnaround. The previous day, he was a persecutor of the church. Today, an evangelist of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is why even believers of his time were afraid to associate themselves with him because of how fiercely he had attacked the church before coming to Christ. They thought it was a trap that Paul wanted to draw them to himself and attack them the more. And I think his experiences also shaped how he related with people around him. No wonder Paul was never at home with anyone that will compromise the gospel message of Jesus Christ in any way. Even Peter, that was considered one of the forefront people among the apostles, Paul drew his attention and said, "You are being a hypocrite. You need to change your attitude." No wonder Paul will look at Galatians and say to them, "You foolish Galatians, who bewitched you? Haven't received the pure gospel And now you are allowing a shallow message to cause you to derail? Paul did not spare the Judaizers who will deceive the believers in Corinth, the believers in Galatia, and other places. He will come out with his guns blazing because he knew at what cost the gospel came to him. Do you know at what cost the gospel reached you? People paid with their lives for us to know Jesus today. It's not something we should joke with. And I feel this is probably one of the main reasons why someone that has been terribly bad in his life, the moment they accept Christ as Lord and Savior, you see such zeal, such passion around them, not minding anyone or anything. They are heavenward focused. Some of us who got it on a platter of gold, we take it for granted. We take it lightly. This gospel message is not to be taken lightly, friends. And Paul understood that all the better. And when you read his words, you check his background, you will understand what we're talking about. And that is why he would say boldly that for him to live was the gospel and to die was a benefit for him. He never considered anything to be more important than the gospel, including his comfort and desires. But what do we have today? This is missing in our Christianity today. We love comfort. We love our enjoyment. And we have forgotten why we are even here on earth. And so Paul will want the believers in Corinth to understand the place that God has given to them. Now, talking about Corinth, Paul's relationship and encounter with the church in Corinth will give you a perspective about why he will talk to them about what we are looking at in this passage. These are people who were known to be grossly immoral to the point that the name of the city was synonymous with sexual immorality. So to them, to practice sexual immorality was also called to Corinthianize because of how they indulge in it. Why? Because even in their temples, sexual immorality was an act of worship to their idols. So it became a lifestyle. And some of them were dragging it into the community of believers. So it became a problem. Paul needed to address it. And clearly, if you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1 from verse 4 to 7, Paul made it clear that the church in Corinth was gifted in many ways. But they were riddled with all kinds of issues, ranging from division in the church, drunkenness, sexual immorality, abuse of the Lord's Supper. Some of them will come to Holy Communion and they are already drunk with alcohol. And that is why Paul will say to them, that is why some of you have even died because of God's judgment. They were just carrying over the old man into the church. And that is why it is important for us to take note of this fact. That not all people you see in the community of believers that you consider to be gifted that are spiritual. We need to be very careful when we're around such people. And so this is why the issue of reconciliation, new covenant, and the aspect of new creation that Paul is talking about here, and he will go further, talk about the heavenly dwelling of believers. These were at the center of this letter that Paul has written to the believers in Corinth. And I want, with God's help, to look at the text, just the section we've looked at, in 2 points, and then we conclude. And one key question we shall seek to answer from the points we will raise is that, what is the basis to being reconcilers? And why should that ministry of reconciliation be our focus? So this is the one but dual question that we are asking. What is the basis to being reconcilers? And why should the ministry of reconciliation be our focus? So the first point talks about a new creation. And the idea of this point is that the basis that we have to engage in this ministry of reconciling the world to God is that we are a new creation. Or for anyone to be engaged in this ministry, they must first become this new creation that Paul is talking about. New creation, in biblical standpoint, is not a reconstruction or a renovation, but it's a new product that is being brought out. And so this is the heart of reconciliation, that God himself is returning what was his own from the start. And what am I trying to say here? This idea of new creation that Paul is talking about, God is not abandoning his children that he has created himself. Because you have to go back to Genesis and understand that many times, when we look at the idea, the narrative in Genesis, we make it look like Jesus died to redeem us from the hand of Satan, who has taken us and has gone away with us. And so the question I always ask to this is, who created us? Satan? Satan? Who created us? God created us. And when God created the world and all of us in the world, he made us and everything perfect. Because at the end of every function he will perform about creation, he will say what? This is good. In French, they will say, ça c'est bien. I've tried, right? This is good. But then we spoil everything. And Paul will say in Romans, by that we've become prisoners to sin. The flesh has taken over. And God in Christ made a provision of reconciling what was his from the start to come back home. So this new creation can only come to be through the person of Christ. And one interesting thing I want to share with us is that the plan for this reconciliation was done before the earth was created. The scripture tells us about Jesus being the Lamb of God that was slain from when? From before the creation of the world. It didn't take Jesus by surprise. It didn't take God unawares that things had gone south. He had captured everything in his plan. God made provision ahead to fix what was still good, even before it got corrupted. And you will see how this also connects back to the writing of the prophets. I'm just so excited when you look at the unity of the scripture. Prophet Isaiah, about 150 years before the children of Israel were taken to captive and even returned back to the land, he saw it. God showed him. And he mentioned about how that the children of Israel, not only that they will be taken into exile, but they will be returned back. And his prophecy, it was so precise that even names were mentioned. If you read Isaiah, you would see that. So especially Isaiah 49 verse 8, he talked about the restoration of God's children. But then, if you look closely at that prophecy, you would see that Isaiah's prophecy had far-reaching implications, projected into the future, talked about the salvation that was going to come through God by the blood of the Lamb, where restoration is now going to take place. So when Isaiah was talking about restoration, he didn't just talk about the children of Israel restored back to the promised land. No. He went ahead to talk about the restoration of mankind to God, the owner, the original owner and creator. And he talked about that prophecy had the implication about the coming of Christ and reconciling us together with our Father. Bringing peace. You know, the scripture tells us that we were enemies with God, but Jesus has come and has reconciled us. And you come to see how Jeremiah and Ezekiel also keyed into that message. Of course, Jeremiah and Ezekiel came way after Isaiah had gone, but built on what Isaiah has mentioned. And what they added in order to paint the picture clearer is when they said, God was going to take away our heart of stone and give us what kind of heart? A heart of flesh. Why a heart of flesh? A heart that is soft, a heart that is malleable, a heart that can be shaped, shaped by the master and the owner, where the law of the Lord is no longer on stone tablets, but inside of the heart of man. A deposit that God is going to place in us, the presence of his Holy Spirit that guarantees our future glory while we are still here on earth, the presence of the Holy Spirit inside of us. Can you ask for anything more? Talk about the hope of glory. When the covenant will be renewed in Christ, that heart of flesh will be given. But friends, it has happened, and we live in that time now. You and I have a heart of flesh that can listen and respond and obey God. That is what the heart of flesh is about. But then, that is not the end, friends. There's a bigger one ahead. I'm not sure if you have seen it. What I'm trying to say here, friends, is this. This is leading to some place, and we are not there yet. We have the assurance now. We have the guarantee now. But we are not there yet. It's about the glory in the future. But we must start here, and we must understand that our first missionary task, before anything, is, as Paul said it, to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. And this is the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ that he has given us this newness, that while we're here on earth in this fallen body, we have that assurance that this glory awaits us even way ahead. And so by this newness, we have been set apart to be a special people. We are now a holy people. Yes, we live in a fallen world, and we'll constantly face trials, we'll face hardships, we'll face challenges, and as you said in your theme, we'll face dark days. We will face all of those. But that is the process that will ensure our sanctification. No wonder Romans 5, the text we have read for the scripture reading, will tell us clearly that all of these pressures of the world to God's children, they may look unpleasant, but they are molding us, they are shaping us into something. And James added in chapter 1 of James, verse 2 to 4, where he talks about how trials and hardships will come to believers in order to produce Christian maturity. So for the world, all of the pressures is to their judgment or to their condemnation. But to God's children, it is to shape us towards sanctification. Enjoying in part that glory while we are still here before the time that we'll get to heaven. Amen. But that is not the icing. There is the heavenly body, the glorified heavenly body that is there awaiting us. Amen. I said it here some time back. You remember the time I had some dental procedure. It was so painful. And the doctor asked me when I came in, "What can I do for you?" I said, "I wish you'd be able to take out all the teeth I have and put new, brand new ones for me." And he laughed because he's not able to do that. It won't still solve the problem, friends. So, and in the pains, you know, pain can inspire. In the middle of the pains I was facing with the tooth problem, I said, you know, God is reminding me not to think of this body as my permanent home, so that I don't rejoice staying in it or anything I'll do with it. So not only the tooth problem I have, many other issues have happened to this body. And the more it's happening, the more I'm feeling, when am I going to be set free from this body and get the heavenly one? Do we long for that? This one ages. He wrinkles. In fact, maybe one of the fears I have is that I don't get all wrinkly and then I get to heaven like that. But that's not going to happen. The glorified body is nothing like this one. We've never seen it before. I envy those apostles. They saw Jesus with the glorified body. God did not allow them to paint a picture or snap any of the pictures so we can see today, so that it will spark us to long for it ourselves. Let us see it with our own eyes of faith, when we get there. Even the story of Eden will tell us the perfect body that Adam had before the fall. Yet, we cannot even be able to have a glimpse of what that looked like. But yes, we have that hope. We may still be in this world, and by all means, this world must feel our impact. But I tell you, friends, you cannot be in Christ and be of this world. It's impossible. These two cannot be one. Where you have the source of pure water, salt water cannot be there as well. Now lead us to the second point. Reconciled to reconcile. First, we said one of the bases and one of the provisions is the new creation. Then the second point talks about a new assignment. And what are we trying to say here? This new creation that we're talking about calls for a new assignment, invariably a new responsibility. Many times we talk about salvation to say faith alone, and sins from past, present, and future forgiven. And some would say that salvation has set them free and they can even go and sin and then it's okay. And anytime I hear that, I say this person does not have a good understanding of salvation. Remember, when Jesus was talking about salvation, he says, take my yoke upon thee and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in the heart. My yoke is what? It's easy. And my burden is light. Which means there is burden, but then it's light. So there is responsibility, friends. Remember, we have been set free from the clutches of sin, from slavery to Satan, so we become slaves to our Lord and Master. We are not set free to be free agents. Just fly off and you are okay on your own. That is not what salvation is talking about. This newness of life must be lived out. The principles of this newness of life is what Paul is laying out for us here in this small section that we have read. What is the fruit of that newness? Look at verse 21. Paul says, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become what? The righteousness of God. One of my favorite passages in the scripture. God made him who had no sin. So what this simply means that we becoming righteousness of God is that when God looks at us, he looks at us through these lenses, and these lenses is Jesus. And he sees us, the righteousness of his son. That is what he sees. Because Jesus died in our place. This fruit implies that we are in right standing with God. This is what shows us and presents us out as God's children. And it is called living a holy life. And that is what verse 17 says of our passage. It says, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has gone and the new is here. This is the newness. We've been set apart. We've been made holy. And Paul will tell us more that this is made possible for a reason. And this is the heart of Paul's argument, especially in Romans chapter 7, where he says that when we were in the flesh, we were controlled by the sinful nature, which of course will naturally produce fruit of the world that leads to death. But then he added, but now that we are in Christ, we have been set free to now live in the newness of life through the Spirit of God that gives us new life. Amen. So the new life is not to be lived in isolation. It's not to be lived in a vacuum. We have an active responsibility, not only to ourselves, but also in engaging the public space, that the larger society is able to look at us and see the light of Christ. And reconciliation is that which we have received in the death of Jesus Christ, as Paul is capturing here, that through us, just as Jesus has reconciled us with God the Father, that in the past, as again Romans will capture, we were God's object of wrath. And what that means is, as a friend of mine would say, if God were to fashion his anger and turn it into an arrow, then it's you that is the target. And you can imagine if God's anger is directed at you. You know, the scripture says it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of our living God. It's a fearful thing. You don't want to know about it. And so God in Christ has reconciled us to himself, and now through us, the remaining part of the world has been reconciled to Christ. Which is why I will always maintain this position, that you sit and reconcile believers and unbelievers is not possible. You can come up with ways that we can have some form of peaceful coexistence, but when you take reconciliation in its original term, it is not possible, because first, the world must be reconciled to Christ before we can now be reconciled to one another. Paul talks about Jesus as the righteousness of God, as been revealed in Romans 1:17. And having become who now God calls his righteousness, we must take that righteousness to the world. So this is the summary and the logic of the gospel message. And this is what Paul is presenting to us. And this is his work, his life. This ministry of reconciliation implies that we are witnesses, that we are people who have become like Christ. And that is why it pains me. It pains me, it grieves my heart. When I walk around the streets or go down the road, and in communities, so-called communities of believers or Christian communities, I see things that sadden my heart. And recently I was taking our kids to school, and I saw something that made me laugh. I said, oh, I really feel so sorry for this lady. And especially for ladies, especially. It's unfortunate I'm using this particular one as an example. I want you to know that when you invite someone to be a Christian, you are telling them to be like you. Because this is what the newness is about. But what I saw is this lady wearing skin tight, a short skin tight, and the top is up here. But then the down is a short one, which is just halfway to the knee. And she carried a handbag, probably going either to work or to town or someplace, and leaves just so little to the imagination about everything about her. And you think that person can be a witness for Christ? And you go out there and the world looks at you and you invite them to be Christians, and they look at you and they say, if this is what Christianity is about, woe unto the Christians. That is the mess we have made out there, and we are wondering why we are not making impact. You go out there half naked. And so all of this nonsense is being associated with Christianity. Because the people who are seen out there are those who profess Christianity. They come out from our communities. And you know the funniest part? She wore gele. You know this thing that women put on? So she covered the head well, but then skin tight. It's sad. It's sad. We say one thing, we do another thing. This new assignment is about us giving what we have received through the Great Commission. And that is what the call to being agents of reconciliation is all about. Because this world we live in is sick and dying. It is only the transforming power of God that can bring transformation. And we are those agents. And I want us to remember, the chief purpose of the existence of man on earth is to worship God. And I can tell you, because I see many times worshiping has become secondary, and we're pursuing other things. Christ will remind us to seek first his kingdom, because that is why we are here. And if you are not able to identify that which God has placed in you to do, having been renewed, it doesn't matter how big it is. You may be in a small corner where no one notices you. You may be on a very high platform. It doesn't matter. What is most important is that you identify what God has called you to accomplish. And if you miss that, then every other thing you are doing is useless. It's useless, friends. It's going nowhere. Man is no longer an alien or enemy, but a child of God. Reconciliation has in itself a change of attitude. And when we say we are these new people, we must be seen with a new attitude. But if you claim to have been reconciled with Christ, but then your nature, your character is not reflecting that, something is wrong. Something is wrong. You need to check. Because we want to see people grow to greater heights, to grow in grace. But then you are with us and claim to be one of us, but your own is going down. It's going down. It's going down. And you think you are okay. There's a problem somewhere. And these things must be corrected. And just to say a few things in view of the women's sub-theme, I want to mention this, especially to our women. Do not allow the darkness to swallow you up. Do you allow the darkness to swallow you up, or do you rise up to be witnesses for Christ, who is your hope of glory? When all seem dark, what do? You languish in lamentations, or you rise up and dare the challenge? There is an old women fellowship song in Hausa. Mumatai babangrundunache. Do you know? Ahaba. Shaila bishara mumatai babangrundunache. Zamushela bishara koina. You know, I grew up in the church. What the song is saying, that women are a great army. And in the context of women's fellowship, are you still that great army? Are you going to allow the darkness to swallow you up, or are you going to rise up and be that army and declare the gospel of Jesus? So you must rise up even in the middle of the darkness and serve the Lord. Do not be the reason to the dark times and the hopelessness that you witness in your life, because some are really in that category. But I want you to also know that the enemy attacks what he knows has great potentials. And that is why you are always in the face of attack. Because you see, you cripple women and you cripple the society. If you are wondering who invented career women, I'm not going to say it here. If you have a home that the husband is loosed, but the woman is standing, that home will survive. But if you have a home that the man is standing, but the woman is loose, that home is finished. You are the backbone. You don't know. Why do you think Satan targeted the woman? The backbone. Why are we having a fallen society today? Because many of you, you've abdicated your position. Oh yeah, you think you are there, but you've really gone somewhere. And research has shown, you destroy the family fabric, the society is gone. And I will add, you destroy women, the family is finished. You are a formidable force when you are united. And I want to advise you that when you come together, do not tear each other apart. Remember, the main aim of your fellowship is what? Say again. To unite women. So that women will do what? You said it when we started the service. I heard you recite it. The object is like we did when we still do in Boys Brigade. See, the object of the Boys Brigade is the advancement of what? Among who? And the promotion of? And what? You think I forgot that? So your ministry of reconciliation must start from your home. It must move to your fellowship so that it can permeate the church and then the marketplace. And that is how you are able to impact the world. Remember, we are reconciled to God in order that we reconcile all of creation to God. And God is still in the business of reconciling the world to himself. And we are called by God to be his agents of reconciliation to the world. Amen. In conclusion, I want us to understand this, that it is a great privilege that God is counting you and I worthy of being partners with him in the business of reconciliation. That is bringing back his children to himself and renewing our world to his glory. So reconciling the world to Christ is a call for us to be ambassadors of the gospel. It is not for us to focus on some of these small problems and issues that we have that they seek to distract us. And I said it before, women in Africa, you are really doing a lot. You carry a lot, and you suffer the most. The kinds of issues that you have to live with, I tell you, when you come and you sing, I'm surprised. You know, us men, we cannot do that. We don't have that muscle. No, it's the truth. You think if you tell them the truth, you'll be demeaning yourself? No. They have more muscle than we can carry. We like carrying our shoulders high and say, I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. When you hear a man keep saying, I'm the man, he's the one that is confused. Who is challenging you as the man? Let's focus on these real issues called souls of men. That is bigger than our small problems. Yes, there is a huge challenge in this success story. Many will carry over the old man, the old past life, into the community of believers. So they are sitting with us, but they still live a sinful life and claim to be among us. They are with us, but they are not part of us. And they are the most dangerous. And I warn you, to change your life before it is too late. Some of you think because you were born in Christian homes and you are with us all the time, it makes you a Christian. Wrong. That is why your life has not been transformed. You still live in the old nature that this text is talking about. You need to be revived. And some are here as agents of Satan trying to scuttle the fellowship of believers. Beware. This church belongs to God and is watching you. And if you don't repent, he'll find you out. He'll bring you out and he'll deal with you. But we are opened. We can help you to meet Jesus. We want you to come so that you can be saved. If you've never accepted Christ as a Lord and Savior, this newness has not reached you yet. And so you cannot be agent of reconciliation. You will instead be bringing destruction. But the agents of darkness will never succeed in Jesus' name. As long as the church is here, the scripture tells us the gates of hell can never prevail against the church. We are more than conquerors. We are a people of hope. And this hope is the hope of glory. And it doesn't matter the opposition that we face in this world today. It should make us better Christians. I want to end with the story of two people, one of they were brothers, and I learned that it was a true story, and it happened over a century ago. One became president, but one was preacher in the United States. But the preacher was in a location where he faced all kinds of hardship because one man gave him trouble. That man gave him trouble. He became a thorn in his flesh. And then one day, that man committed a crime. And they put him in prison and sentenced him to death. If you were that preacher, what would you do? Say, his own has finally what? Caught up with him. Now he will enter. But the preacher trekked miles to go to where that fellow was being sentenced to death, and he appealed that the life of this man be spared. Can you believe that? They said, no, because he's your friend, you want to plead for his life, we'll still kill him. He said, no, you don't understand. This man is a thorn in my flesh. Ordinarily, I would ask for his death, but I'm pleading for his life. But because they understood that indeed he was his enemy, but he was still appealing for his life, they granted him pardon. Yes. And together with the preacher, they trekked back to their village and had a very long conversation along the way. And that led to this thorn accepting Christ as his Lord and Savior. You see, those who are persecuting us, one day, when their work is done of helping us to become more shaped, they will accept Jesus. You see, it may not happen in our lifetime, but God is at work. And that is why we need to trust in Christ, who gives us strength to the end. Amen. Amen. Let's bow our heads and reflect upon these words that God has blessed us with. And just ask God for grace and strength to live in these trying times and succeed.
I want you to speak to God concerning the word we've had. What resolution are you making today? As we pray for ourselves, if you are among those who will be baptized, you can step out. I want you to pray for yourself. Pray for your family. Pray for our state. Pray for this nation. Our Father, we thank you for your word. We ask, O God, that you will help us to live out this word we've had today in our families, in our workplaces, in the marketplace, wherever we find ourselves, that through our lives who will preach the gospel. We thank you. Thank you for your servant, O God. We pray that you continue to strengthen him. For in Jesus' name we have prayed.